a strong, perfectly, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives in peace for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can be before the throne of God above. I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives in peace for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me this depart, no tongue. Soul is purchased with his blood. My life.
goes on between us. Make me one you can trust. Make me one you can change the world through. This blood is yours. This breath. Flesh is
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Grace. Merry Christmas from our family to yours. Hope you're having a wonderful day. Looking forward to Christmas Eve this week. Doug Ford made an announcement on Friday, and the update is that it doesn't really affect churches. We're already more or less at 50% capacity, so there's no real update there. We're moving ahead as scheduled for Christmas Eve. There are 11 spots left on the 5:30 service, so as of today, this filming. And so we may open up a few more, so if it's Sunday morning and you've tried, just check again. We may open up a few extra spots on each service just to accommodate any overflow, but we're looking forward to seeing you there. And other than that, we don't have any big Christmas announcements or any announcements really, other than the end of the year is coming. So if you are wanting to get giving in for 2021, we encourage you to get it done before the 26th, because that's going to be our last live Sunday, online Sunday, but last Sunday in the year that you can give. So we have a special announcement though, because it is it's a special Sunday. So Avery, do you want to just tell everybody what's about to happen?
Okay, so without further ado, I'm here to present you the 2021 Grace Kids Christmas movie.
We want to welcome you today, Between Two Trees. We have our first guest speaker ever, Judah River John. We've got a few questions for you today, Judah. Do you mind answering these questions? You do mind? Oh, perfect. First question we have for you is, what's one thing that has surprised you? Mommy surprised you?
No, Jesus.
Jesus surprised you?
Yeah.
How did he surprise you? With chocolate?
Yeah.
I thought so. Now, Judah, do you know the Christmas story by chance?
Yeah.
Can you tell me anything about this story? What happens? What happens? You turn right?
Yeah.
Are you talking about when Mary and Joseph were on the donkey?
Yeah.
And then they had to turn right?
Yeah.
Do you remember what they went into?
Yeah.
What was it?
A farm.
A farm?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What was in the farm?
Donkey, sheep, chickens.
Now, Judah, tell me about the way in which Jesus, before he was born, Mary and Joseph, how did they get to the barn? Because there's some controversy. Do you know how they got there?
Yeah.
What did they ride?
Tiger.
A tractor?
No.
No?
Tiger.
A tiger?
Yeah.
Where did you learn that he rode a tiger?
Daddy.
Was it Daddy as a tiger? I don't know what you're talking about. Do you have any songs you'd like to sing for us today?
Yeah, Jesus, Judah. The Bible, Daddy song.
Judah, thank you for joining us, Between Two Trees. What's that? No way. This just in, we just acquired a bunch more special guests that are going to go further into telling us this Christmas story. So let's cut to...
What's a big surprise you've had before? Have you ever been surprised by something?
All my friends stumbled over to my birthday. That's a big present.
And what, did they say surprise?
Yeah.
Surprise!
Tell me about the big surprise that God did on Christmas.
Mary, Joseph, Joseph, Jesus.
What would you do if you saw an
angel? Pray to God.
Have you ever had a big surprise? Like on your birthday?
When I woke up and on my birthday I saw this, it's a big balloon that had ninja stickers all over.
What was your face like when you saw What did you ask for Christmas?
I asked for this flipping tiger car, so it's a remote control tiger car.
Wait.
It flips and it walks and its tires grip the stairs so it can walk up the stairs.
What about you, Kenzie? What did you ask for Christmas? Do you remember?
A teddy bear.
A teddy bear? So how do you think you would feel on Christmas if you opened up a present and that's what was inside? Can you tell me any of the parts of the Christmas story? What do you think Mary, how do you think Mary felt when she found out she was going to have a baby?
Surprised.
An angel came to visit
Mary and Joseph to tell them about they're going to have a baby.
What do you think Mary's face was like when the angel told her? What do you think Joseph's face was like when he found out? And when they got to Bethlehem, could they stay at like a hotel?
No, because the hotel was so full that they couldn't stay. They went to a stable.
What kind of song do you think he'd sing for Jesus if he saw him for the first time?
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, I wonder what you are. Up, up, up the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
That was so beautiful. You have such a nice singing voice.
Thank you. So all the inns are full, so they go to the, it's like a
stable.
Okay. They go to the stable and they stay there with all the animals.
What kind of animals were there, Leo?
What kind of animals were there?
I don't know.
What kind of animals live in a barn?
A fox.
A fox?
A lot of foxes.
A lot of foxes. Oh. Apparently it's a fox barn.
What else happens in the Christmas story? Are there anything in the sky?
A shooting star!
A shooting lion!
And what happened next was they arrived, like Mary, Joseph, and the little one inside, and the donkey. They all arrived. They went house to house, and they all said there was no room for anyone to stay and have a baby.
So far away from the happening were these three shepherds watching their sheep, and then all of the angels came and started singing and dancing for some reason.
And Joseph was definitely surprised. He was gonna be a father of a king, and he wasn't even close to being a king. But after he had that baby, he was pretty close because his son was a king.
I didn't know about that, but it would take a long time.
Do you remember how it starts?
Mary, I was riding the donkey.
Why was she riding the donkey?
Because she was going to Bethlehem.
What was in Bethlehem?
No bed for them.
No
so
bed.
They knocked on the different door and they said they had a manger bed for them. But then there was a monster, but Joseph killed it. It was huge. He was dead because he wasn't being very nice. But it was just a small baby monster. He didn't grow. But God went closer to him, and then the baby monster just kissed Jesus. Then the Grinch decided to go over and eat with them. That's what they did. It's God's birthday today.
Can you say happy birthday, Jesus?
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
I did not say it. I was not ready.
Okay, you ready? 3, 2, 1.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday, Jesus! Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Wasn't that cute? I love those kids. We're actually gonna now watch that story unfold. Stay tuned.
Have you ever wondered what we might see if we could pull back the curtain of time to that very first Christmas? If we could, I imagine it would look something like this. The story began in heaven. God was looking over heaven's balcony, shaking his head at the wrong things people were doing. Then he looked at the stars, smiled, and said,
"It's time."
"Time for what, Lord?"
"Time for my plan to rescue the earth. I feel so far away from my people down there. It's hard to be close to someone when you don't like what they're doing. So we're going to step in."
"Shall we bring in the army, Lord, and teach them a lesson?"
"No, I don't think we should send in an army. Maybe just one person."
"One person?
What?
Brent, they won't be expecting that."
"Lord, if you're only going to send one person down there, they're going to have to be very powerful and strong."
"Because there's lots of people down there."
"No, they don't have to be very powerful or very strong. They'll be going as a newborn baby."
"A newborn baby?
What?"
"Brent, don't be expecting that."
"Lord, this plan is rather risky. A newborn human is small and weak."
"This baby must be born to someone who will protect him, maybe a great ruler or mighty king."
"Actually, I was thinking I could send him to a young peasant girl. Her heart is beautiful and filled with faith."
"A peasant girl?"
"Brent, they won't be expecting that."
"My lord, I see that your plan is to take Earth by surprise, but what good can a baby do?"
"This is not just any baby. I will be sending the Prince of Heaven in disguise."
Your son?
"Brent, they won't be expecting that."
"Lord, this is too risky. Sending the Prince of Heaven down in disguise as a tiny baby? Born not to kings, but to humble villagers.
Surely our prince cannot be born in a cottage, but in a palace."
"You're right. He shouldn't be born in a cottage. He should be born in a stable."
"A stable?
Filled with hay?
Filled with excrement?"
"Brent, they won't be expecting that."
"Lord, how will people know he's here? What if they don't notice?"
"Those who are looking for him will find him. His mission will bring all people closer to me, even if they do something really wrong. When the prince is done, nothing will get between them and my love."
"Can we leave some clues for people looking, like in the stars?"
"Sure. We can make one big one that points to him."
"Can we sing for him?"
"Yes, can we sing?
Sing to welcome him?
Please say we can sing."
God looked at their hopeful faces, and his heart was touched by their love for the prince.
"All right, you can sing."
"Yay!"
"But not to the whole world. That would just be weird. And no kings or rulers."
"How about we sing for some shepherds? That's a lonely job. Maybe they need some cheering up."
"Really, they won't be expecting that."
You know the rest of the story. An angel visited a humble girl with a courageous heart and told her the good news. She would have a baby, and he would be the Prince of Heaven, who would help Earth be close to God again. As planned, the baby was born in a stable, about as far from a palace as you can get. A group of wise men noticed some strange clues in the stars. They packed their belongings and followed the star right to a baby. And of course, a bunch of lonely shepherds were guarding their sheep when all of a sudden the sky was lit up by thousands of angels singing.
Nobody ever expects that.
Born unto us this day, the Savior. Gifted from heaven to a manger. The hope of the world's a lie for all mankind.
Well, that was awesome. Thank you to everybody who put their hard work in, all the parents and kids who participated, of course, to Jason and Judah, to Sarah, and of course, to Lindsay Dorch, our children's coordinator. We so appreciate all your hard work. And lastly, to our intrepid videographer, Kent, who did all the audio video for the series and put it all together. So thank you. Appreciate all your hard work. Awesome. Merry Christmas, everybody. Why don't we pray, and we'll jump right into the message this morning. So Lord, we thank you, God, for all the ways that you are at work in our lives. We thank you for just the things we've been working through and studying in your word through this series. And we ask, God, that you would again today meet us, that you would impart to us fresh bread. Lord, I pray that you'd give us our portion this morning. We just commit our time to you, in your name, Jesus, amen. Well, this is our last week of our series, and I just wanted to just thank you for watching through the promises. I encourage you to get a chance to go back and listen over to any of the things in the past we've been talking about. And really today I want to sort of put a bow, bring it all together, and really what I want to do is commission you as you grapple with the promises of God for your life. And so what I want to do is turn to Genesis 32. We're going to start with scripture this morning, and then we'll go from there. So Genesis 32, and we're going to read from verse 6 to 12, and then from 22 all the way to 32. And just to give you a bit of context for our passage today, is this is a part of the story of Jacob. And it's right near really the end of sort of the big drama in Jacob's life. He's meeting his brother Esau. And so that's where we're going to jump in. So verse 6 says, "And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, 'We came to your brother Esau, and he is actually coming to meet you. And there are 400 men with him.' Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed, and he divided the people who were with him, the flocks and the herds and camels, into two camps, thinking, 'If Esau comes to one camp and attacks it, then the camp that is left will escape.' And then he prays. Jacob said, 'O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, "Return to your country and to your kindred, that I may do good to you. I am not worthy of least of all the deeds of steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown your servant. For with only my staff I crossed this Jordan, and now I have become two camps. Please deliver me from the hand of my brother and from the hand of Esau, for I fear him that he may come and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude." We're going to jump forward to verse 22. That same night, He arose and took his two wives, two female servants, and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and he sent them across the stream and everything else that he had, and Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." And then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the people of Israel do not eat the sinew of the thigh that is on the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip on the sinew of his thigh. Well, one of my favorite things to do as a kid with my dad, and one of the things, my favorite things to do now as a dad myself, is to wrestle with my kids. There's something just totally delightful about having some little body exerting all of its force against you. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. You probably wrestled with your dad, but it's so much fun watching the kids strategize as they think about how they're going to slay this immovable giant that stands in front of them. And, you know, to hear their tiny little blood-curdling screams as they find a pillow that's much too big for them and try and leverage it over their head in order to bring it down violently upon this hideous monster that stands in front of them. To see them come kind of all of a sudden come flying over your shoulder, suddenly airborne, landing on your back like a kamikaze cowboy, snarling as they climb you like they're riding a bucking bronco. But it's not really war, it's really joy. And that's exactly the kind of fun bonding experience that I enjoyed as I've wrestled with each of my first three kids. It was some of my favorite memories. Laughing, it's always playful, it's blissful. Hopefully no one gets hurt. I'm there not using my full force, just enough to make it a challenge for them. So you can imagine then my surprise when our youngest, Leo, who's 3 years old now, came along and everything changed. See, for some reason with Leo, when we wrestle, our wrestling is not play for him. For him, wrestling is serious business. It's somehow life and death. It is absolute war. It's not punctuated with any of the sounds of laughter, but only these tiny grunts and high-pitched screams of a child attempting to exert his dominance upon me, to make his mark in this world. And when I watch him struggling and pushing and exerting his will, I'm suddenly faced with this predicament. What should I do? What do I do? Do I stop wrestling with him? Do I get him to calm down a little bit? You know, this is just make-believe. This isn't real. Make sure that he understands it's just play. It's not really life and death. You don't need to really try and hurt Dad. No, I don't do that. I simply let Leo do his worst. I let him go all out. I let him feel the weight of his swings as he hits me. I let him get a feel for where the edge of the bed is as he moves around, and sometimes he falls as he fights for his life as he thinks about it. I let him discover what parts of him are best to keep protected and what parts are sturdy for battle. I want him to figure out how to move his body and coordinate his strategy and think about his attack. I let him feel constrained sometimes, and then I let him wriggle free. I let him feel what it's like to meet his match. And I let him know that while somehow he's not going to lose this fight that he's in, he certainly won't win in the way that he wants. Now, why? Why do we do that? Why do I do that? Well, first, the reason is that I want him to know, I know he needs to learn how to wrestle. Leo needs to learn how to wrestle. I think it's important that he learns to internalize this message from a young age, this truth that life is all about struggle. Do you believe that? Life is all about struggle. To live is to strive. And I want us to know this morning that that isn't a bad or even evil thing to wrestle or to fight. In fact, to struggle is actually good. It's from God. Challenge, we know, is necessary in life. We all know for children to learn to struggle is critical for their healthy development. A child that never struggles never grows. Children begin to grow the moment that they learn to engage in the work of struggle. To have to wrestle with things that are at this moment beyond them and then eventually master them. To rise to the challenge that's being set before them. We have to, somehow we've moralized most failure in life. We think failure is wrong or bad, and we've done that unnecessarily and to our detriment. I don't mean to say that all failure is, that there isn't a kind of failure that is bad, but most of the failure that we experience isn't bad or good, and we've done it to our detriment. And so that's why I let Leo fight, because I want him to know, to have this experience of wrestling with things in this life, that when we do that, it's not just a result of evil being at work in the world, and therefore this whole idea of struggle should be avoided at all costs, that somehow the good life doesn't have struggle. No, I want him to realize that there is a necessary, a beneficial struggle that happens the very moment we decide to enter into the work of creating anything good. The moment you do something good, you enter into the struggle. I want him to know that he was made for that kind of fight. He was made to do good things in this world. And you, too, are made for that kind of battle. We all are. See, all of the good work where we are every day exerting energy in our making, our creating, our leading, or our laboring, all of it requires us to wrestle with complex problems so that we can bring order out of the chaos around us. Think about it. We're all wrestling with important things in our lives. I'm sure that you are. Probably many important things at once. And sometimes we feel overwhelmed with all of the important things that require our attention. Our work, our families, our health, our future, our communities, or the health of our communities, our values being instilled. And we're wrestling. Why? Because we, like Leo, have this innate desire to a drive within us to make our mark in this world. We all know inherently, don't we, that we were made to have an impact. Even if we're not, we know that we were made to. We were made to lay hold of the promise that life seems to offer, that there is potential in everything and every person. And that's what Jacob, I think, knows is at work in his own life. When we find Jacob in our story, he knows that there is something about his life. From before he was born, we're told that his life is entangled in this complex problem of this divine promise that's over his life. And it's the same really for each of us, whether we understand it or not, is there is a complex problem of the promises of God over each of our lives. Jacob is aware of this call upon his life. He hears it. He understands it internally from a young age. He feels the gravity and the responsibility to grab hold of the future somehow, to play the angles in life so he can navigate into those hidden possibilities that lay, you know, beneath the problems and trials. For Jacob, and I think for us, life is not something to leave to chance. Life isn't something that happens to us Life is something that we make of it. And that in itself is not wrong. And none of us are any different. We all want our lives to matter. We all want our lives to matter at the end of the day. We all want to make things better somehow. We all want things to eventually be easier than when we started. We don't want to repeat the errors or the errors of the past. We want to make things more equitable than they used to be. We want to make things more beautiful than when we found them. We learn to do that as we struggle. We all want to bring order to the chaos. We all want to overcome darkness in our own way. We all want to be a part of building this life, a family that matters. And because of this, we must wrestle. And we do. We all wrestle. And that's part of the reason why I don't stop Leo when he fights, when he puts all of his effort into something, when he engages in the struggle. But that isn't really the deepest reason that I don't correct him. Because the kind of wrestling that Leo and I do is different, isn't it? If you take notice of the story, this moment, this wrestling that Jacob has with this man who's really God was different, wasn't it, from the kind of wrestling that he did in the rest of his life? The struggle that Jacob's used to, the struggle with the Esaus and the Labans and the Rachels and the Leahs, it's different than the kind of match he finds himself sort of pulled into or attacked as he stands at the river. The normal wrestling in life for Jacob has been really full of pain. It's been disappointment. It's been driven by fear and self-protection, getting what he wants, how he wants it. But this wrestling that happens in the river with God and my wrestling that happens with Leo on our bed turns all of that on its head. See, even though I'm fighting with Leo, there's something else happening. I'm fighting with Leo, but I love him. Even though I'm wrestling with his kicks and his punches, I'm only there because of how deeply I care for him. Even though I'm pushing back against all of his violent advances, it's only so that he will discover who he really is and what he's really capable of. Even though as I'm grabbing him and it feels to him like I'm pulling him down, it's only so I can interrupt all of his fury with a gentle kiss. And that's exactly what Jacob discovers about God, doesn't he? It's the kind of wrestling I hope we all encounter, and I hope for all of my kids, including Leo, that they all encounter this kind of wrestling, because even though it's not like the kind of wrestling that they'll find and they'll have to do out in the world, I tell you this, it's the most important kind to pursue. And it's the most important kind because if we can somehow grasp that it's good to struggle, if we can internalize that it's good to struggle, that it's normal to wrestle first with the one who loves us most, that in the safety of the Father's love, we can be really, really honest. We can bring to bear all of our violent frustration, that we can open up the pain in our souls in struggle with him. We'll actually, in that moment, have laid hold of the secret to overcoming in every other struggle that life will bring. There is an elemental struggle that we all must face. See, the most important struggle in any of our lives isn't our struggle with the problems that we face. That isn't the struggle in your life, the most important one. It isn't the struggle you face in your relationships, the problems that you deal with in your work, or even the problems we face within our own hearts and lives, our souls. Our most important struggle is with the problem of God. Do you know that? God is a problem for you, and you've got to deal with him. God is a problem. God is a problem because he's been interrupting your life. I imagine this is true. I know it's true. God's been interrupting your life. God's been interrupting your best plans. God's been interrupting the peace that you've been pursuing on your own. And he wants your attention this morning. God's a problem. And he will not be ignored. God is the problem, and we like Jacob must come face to face with him. So let me ask you, do you wrestle with God? Have you wrestled with God? Or how long has it been since you really wrestled with God? If you don't, or if you haven't, or if it's been a while, it's probably because you've either never deeply understood or entertained God's incredible promises. You've just been down maybe for so long, you haven't, or your life has been crushing you in a way that you never expected. And so you can't really believe or connect that God has good things for you. You just keep the promises at bay because it's too hard to think about them. It's one reason why you're not wrestling with God. Or maybe you have. You've considered those promises. You know that they're true somehow about your life, that there's a good life, there's blessing. There's broad, wide open, spacious living that's in front of you. But like Jacob, you haven't realized that you really have permission to wrestle with God, that you need to wrestle with God. And like Jacob, you've heard the call, you've been aware of the promise, but you probably have tried to attain that blessing through struggling with those around you instead. You haven't been fighting with God, you've been fighting with everybody else. You've been fighting with problems. You thought you had to fight with others to get what God promised. But I want to tell us this morning that we don't have to settle for either of those options in our lives. See, my hope this morning is that we've looked at all of these promises as we've considered the heart of a father who redeems and makes covenant, binds himself to us over these last few months, that somehow in that you've grown a bit impatient. My hope is that you've become a little bit more frustrated, a little more angsty, a little more curious with your current reality with God. And I'm hoping that maybe there's been a renewed longing within you, a yearning hope that there's something better for your life. And that is really my goal, that maybe you might even feel a bit upset, maybe a bit jaded as we've talked about the promises or talked about just asking God, maybe even a bit angry, almost like you could fight about it. Well, don't you see? That is exactly what a promise is for. A promise is given by God to us to provoke you not to settle for less than God has for you. A promise is there to provoke you to find the God who answers your prayer. That's what a promise is for. So we will not learn what we need to learn in this life unless we learn it by wrestling with God. There is no other way because there is no other source for real life. God's the source, His way, His kingdom, His righteousness. But more than that, if we never learn to wrestle with God, we will not know how to properly wrestle with everything else. Without learning to wrestle with God, all of our struggles in life will end up leading us into brokenness instead of into breakthrough. And that's what Jacob's story is really all about. He thought he was Jacob. He asked him, "What's your name?" All of this is about your name. He said, "What's your name?" And Jacob says, "It's Jacob. I'm just the deceiver. I'm the usurper." He knows that he's labored and he has striven. He's fought and he's wrestled under that name. But he's done so and he's carried that burden unnecessarily. Because God's intent the whole time was that one day he could face the real problem in his life. The problem of the promise made by the God who loved him. And that when he did, he would be transformed by it. No longer, and this is what happens in this moment, no longer would he have to be Jacob, the heel grabber, but Israel, the one who fights with God, who enters into the fray of wrestling with the Almighty and finds out that he prevails somehow. He's not wrestling with his enemies. He's wrestling with a father who loves him. Israel means actually, it's this pronouncement. Israel doesn't mean, you know, as a name, the etymology isn't that you fight with God and you win. Israel just means God fights. So he gets this promise that this is who you are. You're the one who fights with God and wins, but your name is going to be God fights, or God fights for you, or God protects you, or God prepares you or redeems you. That's what Israel means. It's this action of God. It's a promise that God will do it. And that's what Jacob discovers. Not only is he the one who wrestles with God's promises and holds on until he's blessed, and that's God's intent, but God is the one who fights his battles for him so he doesn't have to anymore. Jacob doesn't have to go and face his brother alone. God will fight his battles. Jacob discovers that if he struggles with God, if you struggle with God for the promise, you can stand in peace with everyone else. Stand in peace in your marriage. Stand in peace in your relationship. Stand in peace against anxiety or fear. Is it plain yet? The way that I wrestle with Leo is exactly the way that God the Father wrestles with us. He knows that struggle is necessary for us to grow, and so he doesn't stop us. He's not afraid of us. Instead, he participates fully. But he doesn't show up in the fullness of his strength, does he? No, he condescends with Jacob, and he condescends with us. He becomes weak on our behalf. I mean, it's Christmas after all. Jesus, God himself, became flesh. He became weak and lowly on our behalf, and yet he lets us know that even there, we've met our match. He could come and overpower us, of course, in a moment, but he allows us to be shaped and formed as we press up against him. As we fight, we discover who we are. He knows it's only as we wrestle will we find out our true identity. Who are you? If you've never wrestled with God, maybe you don't yet know. Maybe there's a whole future in life that only comes as you bring your fight to God. And that's what happens for Jacob. As he wrestles with God, he finds he's not a deceiver like he thought that he was. That's not his identity. He's not really a usurper. No, the whole time he was the divine wrestler who has become, who because he has truly struggled with God, has learned the secret of prevailing in life. See, God wants him not so much to win the fight that he thought that he was fighting. God wants to bless him, but he interrupts when Jacob says, God, bless me. Would you bless me? I'm not leaving until you bless me. And he says, no. I'm going to bless you, but you need to know something about yourself. What's your name? God doesn't so much concern himself with the fight that Jacob thinks he's fighting. And so often that's true of us. We're fighting this fight with God for this thing that we think we want, or this way forward. But God doesn't let us win the fight the way that we thought. But he wants us instead to prevail into the blessing that God has wanted to give us. He doesn't let us win the way that we thought we would win, but we win. God has given us instead his precious promises so that we will prevail into the blessing. And that's the function of these many great and precious promises that hang over our lives, that we read last week are being kept in heaven, undefiled, imperishable, and unfading for you, that we enter into by faith. And that's really at the core of this. This is a simple message that I wanted to leave with you this morning as we finish our series on God's promises, is that you might realize that those struggles that we all experience as we wrestle with each of God's unique promises, that those struggles with God are deeply good. Do not faint. Do not give up. That the struggle of the process is part of the work of the promise. I'll say that again. The struggle that you experience in the process is a part of the work of the promise. And that's what each of your promises or problems are really about. Discovering the power of God's promise and the provision that he'll make as you walk out his process. It's my prayer that we would realize that the gap that we experience, that exists between God's promise and his fulfillment, is really, it's our call to join him on a journey of life-transforming struggle. Welcome to the battle. Welcome to the battle. And it's not a struggle that we'll win in a way that we ever asked for or thought of or could imagine. God is something even better than we thought. Instead, I hope that, like Leo, it's my prayer this morning that we would each experience the kind of wrestling that ends up with us getting kissed by God, even if it leaves us with a limp. That we would resolve by faith to see that our problems are really just opportunities to discover how brilliantly God's grace is towards us. And it is brilliantly towards you. That these light and momentary afflictions are not to be avoided, but entered into because they are pivotal to discovering who you really are and who God really is. And so I want to end this morning by commissioning you with what I think is a familiar scripture. And I hope you hear it maybe a little bit differently in light of the message that we've just shared. And it's in Ephesians 6, verse 10. And this is how I want you, if you can, just imagine or hear this passage this morning. I want you to hear it as if you're Jacob, because you are. But not Jacob in the old life, you're now Israel, the morning after wrestling with God. I want you to hear this as Israel. You, in a sense, really, you are the new Israel, aren't you? Everybody in Christ is part of his new work. And for Israel, or for Jacob, he has come face to face now with the real problem in his life. He's wrestled himself with the Almighty God, and by his grace, he's prevailed somehow, and his life has been delivered. But even more than that, it says Jacob was given a blessing. It was imparted to him. And I want us just to, as we're listening, I want you to understand that what it means to be blessed for Jacob, it means that he now lives under the blessing of a new name, a new identity from God, a transformation, but that he was never able also, to be Israel means that you never walk right again. You walk with a limp for the rest of your life. For Jacob to be blessed is to live as Israel now, the one who stands in his weakness before God. That's what it means to be Israel, is to be the one who wrestles with God. What does it mean for us to be blessed? It's that we surrender our lives every day as living sacrifices. This is what it means to be Israel, to be bushes that are burned but not consumed, to be those who are weak before God because God is strong. So that we can stand raised up as the strength and the power and the confounding wisdom of God are displayed in us. Jesus himself, it says, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, when they look at him, he is the slain lamb. Let it be for us. I want to read this passage. I want you to hear it as Jacob this morning. Finally, my brothers and sisters, be strong now in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor today of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For listen, we do not wrestle anymore against flesh and blood, Jacob. You're not wrestling with anything else, but against the rulers and against the authorities and against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all of the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all of the saints and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel. So let's pray this morning. Father, you know my heart. Lord, you know, Lord, we're longing, Lord, that we would enter into a new struggle with you, Lord. That we wouldn't be faint-hearted, Lord, about such things that are so important. Lord, all of the promises and the inheritance and the blessing and the grace that you wish to impart, I pray that we would take hold of it as we look to you. Take hold of it by faith as we wrestle with you. Take hold of it by prayer, Lord, as we ask you, Lord, to intervene and to have your way in our lives and to bring your kingdom on the earth, Lord, as it is in heaven. I pray that we would be strengthened and supported and buffeted by the promises of God, that we would live, Lord, not faint-heartedly before you, but with courage and boldness and confidence before you, knowing, God, that you are a Father who has bound himself to us, who redeems our lives, the Lord who is with us, the Lord who is good, the Lord who is our portion, the Lord who provides. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your name, Lord, you, Lord, you're the promise. Your name is the promise. And I pray each person listening this morning, Lord, would sense the strength and the power of your Spirit over their lives. I pray that you would interrupt every plan, Lord, and that we would meet you in the crisis, Lord, of our lives. We'd meet you in the thin place, Lord, of our need. I thank you, Lord, that you meet and hear our cries. Lord, we call upon the name of the Lord, and by it we are saved. In your name, Jesus, amen.